Okay, good morning everyone. Today I am going to discuss about the second part of the democracy, which we discussed some days before in its first part. And in this first part, this is under, you know that this is under course of MPS 1 unit 2. MPS 1, the program is MPS 1, MPS course, paper 1, and unit 2, it is the democracy. So let us start. It is because it is already 11:11, and I inform you that this class will be started from 11 a.m. Now, before we discuss the last part of the second unit, we should go back to the last class. What is democracy? We have discussed about the democracy, its origin and its evolution in America, in France and in England, and then the origin of the word democracy, definition of democracy, historical background of the democracy, then wave of democracy. We have already discussed about the four wave of democracy. What were those four waves? The first wave was the development of the democracy in the West or in Europe during 19th century. The second wave of democracy, we have already stated that it was started from the World War I. After the First World War, the second wave of democracy developed. Third wave of democracy developed after the Second World War. And we discussed the fourth wave of democracy in comparison with the communist or leftist ideology. After that, we discussed the democracy, how it is related with the concept of autonomy, rights, liberty, and equality. In here, I have already said to you that equality, liberty, fraternity, and justice are the four cornerstones, four basic principles, four basic elements, four most important issues of democracy. What are those? Equality, liberty, fraternity, and justice. And all these concepts are closely related with the concept of rights. It is a question of rights where we demand equality. It is a question related to the rights where we demand liberty. It is a question of rights where we demand justice. So, equality, liberty, fraternity, and justice are the four basic concepts of democracy. Then we have discussed the intrinsic and instrumental democracy. What was the intrinsic democracy? When we value a democracy as a good in itself and for itself, we assert the intrinsic value of democracy. And what is instrumental democracy? Institutional democracy may also be valued instrumentally as a means to some other aim. Then what is instrumental democracy? Instrumental, related to the instrumental democracy, we must think that democracy can be valued on the basis of instrumentations or as a means to some other end, to gain something when we structured something, when we formulated something, and when we implemented something, that it becomes instrumental democracy. In the last class, we already discussed about this. Then, come to the next part. What today we are going to discuss? The today's topic of democracy, what I am going to elaborate, it is procedural democracy and substantive democracy. Before we understand the procedural democracy and substantive democracy, we must know the main concept of the democracy, the basic principles of the democracy, basic elements of the democracy, basic goal of the democracy. So I have already said that equality, liberty, fraternity, and justice are the four cornerstone of democracy, four pillars of democracy. If we think these are the four pillars of democracy, then how we can get it, how we can accept it? If we think about that, there may be two types. What are the two types? One is to achieve the goal directly through various means, where every person can realize that they are getting everything what they expected from the democracy. Another one is that when the state able to prove that they are what they are doing, it is in a democratic way, on the basis of the democratic principles, on the basis of the democratic ideology, and in a democratic norms, then this is the true ideology. What actually people get and what state does. What state does and what actually people get. So, when democracy should be seen merely as a set of institutions like free and fair elections, legislative assemblies, and constitutional government arising out of this, these are the procedural democracy. So what is the procedural democracy? When a state is controlled and conducted on the basis of democratic principles, like the government is formed on the basis of elections, there may be seen free and fair elections, there must be legislative assembly constituted by the people's representative, constitutional government, that government is not coming to power by force but on the basis of the constitutional norms, rules and regulations. If it is seen in a state, then we can say that is a state of procedural democracy. It means the procedures are maintained. What are the procedures? By the people, for the people, of the people. What is the by the people? The government is formed by the people through casting their vote. For the people, the governments are taking various policy, aims, objectives, goal for the development of the people. And what is the of the people? Those who form the government, they are coming from the people's group. People's from the people's, they are the people's representative. Like in India, we have seen that after every 5 years, their election has been held. Election always, we have seen the election has been held in India after 5 years. It means it is a democratic country because there is an election system. No persons come into power, no person has come into power by force. Everyone get their power on the basis of democratic principles. So this is the procedural concept. The view of the democracy is described as procedural democracy because it emphasizes only the procedures and institutions of the democracy. So why it is procedural democracy? By process, by rules, by principles, by the structural system, from the structural point of view. If a state is democratic, if the state is following the principles of democracy, if the people are granting the rights to the peoples, then these are the procedural. All the institutions of the state, when it is consistent according to the democratic law, democratic ideology, and this is democratic in nature. So procedural means structurally when a state or all the institutions of the states are formed. That is the procedural democracy to achieve the basic ideology, the equality, liberty, fraternity, and justice. It fails to see that notwithstanding formal political equality, some citizens may be more equal than the others and may enjoy a greater voice than the others in determining of the decisions. When you see the procedural democracy, then we'll find out when the procedure, when the law, when the rules, when the regulations allow us the political rights, the democratic rights, but still we see that a group of the peoples, some group of the peoples or some citizens, some special group always get more privileges than the others. They enjoy more rights than the others. So in here, every citizens can't realize that they are equal to the others, or a group of the peoples may think that they are superior than the others because it is according to the procedures. What is the, like I am saying, the democratic procedure? What is the democratic procedure? That free and fair elections, well-structured legislature, well-structured executive, well-structured judiciary. India has all this. If we see, in India we have seen all this. We have the parliament, we have the president and prime minister and the other council of ministers as the executive, and we have the Supreme Court as the symbol of the judiciary. These all are procedural process. If we will not get the equality, if there may be injustice, then we can go to the police station, we can go to the court, we can pressurize the government, and government must have to think what we demand, and if not they give an importance towards our demands, then we can change them after 5 years through the election. This is the procedure. Everywhere we are following the procedures, how we can get the equality, how we can get the liberty, how we can get the rights, how we can get the fraternity, how we can get the government, how the government functions, what is the Supreme Court, what is the rule of the Supreme Court, how we can go to the Supreme Court, everything we know well. So this is the procedure. This is the procedural democracy. More often than not, it would be the poorer, less educated, and socially disadvantaged citizens who would be unable to fully practice their democratic rights. So, though I am saying that we know the process of elections, we know the process of the legislature, we know the process of the executive, we know the process of the judiciary, but if we see practically, then we will be able to see a group of the peoples, basically those who are marginalized, those who are vulnerable, those who are poor, those who are less educated, those who are socially underdeveloped, such type of peoples can't enjoy the democratic rights in a real sense, in a procedural democracy, because they pay importance, the procedural democracy pays importance on the procedures of the government, on the procedures of the state, and the procedure of the structure, not the basic concept, not the basic ideology, how it should be gained. Procedurally, it is right. You should keep in mind that procedural democracy means that type of democracy which state is procedurally right, which is legally right, which is lawful, which is constitutional. When a government is formed on the basis of the constitution, when a government is formed on the basis of democratic principles, when there are many structures based on the democratic ideology, that is the procedural democracy. But though we have all democratic institutions, executive, legislature, judiciary, and Indian constitutions, but yet some of the peoples out of the concept of equality, out of the ideology of liberty, out of the ideology of justice, they are fighting to get the equality, liberty, and fraternity till today. The fighting is going on. Though we have a well-procedural democracy, but we are still fighting for the real equality, real liberty, real fraternity, and real justice. Social and economic inequalities make it difficult for a formal participation to be effective. When we think about a formal participation of the peoples in politics, in structure, in election, in executive, in legislature, and in judiciary, then we should know before procedural democracy, the peoples must have to know about the real structure, real activities, real value of these political institutions or the political procedures. But most of the peoples are unaware because they are less educated, they are socially disadvantaged or they are not equal to others in real sense. This is why theories emphasize the importance of the substantive democracy. So procedural democracy means when a state is become democratic according to the constitutions, according to the system of the formation of the government, according to the legislative point of view, according to the judicial point of view, these are the procedural democracy. But still having all the democratic institutions, when peoples are fighting to achieve the democratic goals, then we can say that procedural democracy fails to fulfill the expectations of the human being. People's expectations, fulfillment of the people's expectations are the core issue of democracy. Whereas in a procedural democracy, rather fulfill the expectations of the people, they try to fulfill the determinant, formulated, legislated aims, objectives, and goals. When we always think about the constitutions, when we always think about the law made by the government, the rules made by the government, these all are procedural. These are not substantive. It tried to achieve the substantive goal, but this is not the totally substantive. It is a part, it is a process, it is a means to attain the substantive goal of the democracy. Then, next, when you think about the next, the ideal, what is the ideal? The ideal means the substantive democracy. The substantive democracy suggests a society of truly equal citizens. Truly equal citizens. Not procedurally equal. Not according to the law. Not according to the rules. Not according to the constitution. But in practically, the citizens must be equal. This is the basic ideal. This is the basic aim of the substantive democracy. Who are politically engaged to learn of the different opinion and the ways of life and have an equal voice in choosing their rulers and holding them accountable. What does it mean? That not only the peoples will get the real equality, but also irrespective of their class, caste, gender, tribe, language, they must have get opportunity. They must feel the equality in the process of the formation of the government, in the opinion related to their life, and in the process of realizing the future of the nations, how they can take part in the decision-making process. Besides, every ruler should be accountable to the every person, irrespective of their caste, class, creed, language, etc. So, substantive democracy, we can say it is the content of democracy. It is the main democracy. It is a core democracy, core thing of the democracy. The outcomes and decisions of the democratic process would then be mindful of the interest of the all, rather than the interest of the few powerful groups and the individuals in the society. So, the results, the outcomes, the decisions taken by the government and its results and its benefits must be go to everyone, must be benefited the everyone. If everyone will be benefited by the outcomes of the government, then that is the substantive development. But when we see in a procedural democracy, the procedural democracy based on the rules, principles made by the constitutions. According to the Indian constitutions, the leader of the majority party will become the prime minister of India. The leader of the majority party will become the prime minister of India. But if we see the majority political party in the parliament of India, it is a minority government. It is not the majority government. Why not majority? If you see that no ruling political party till today got more than 50% of the vote of the nations, they have got only less than 50% of vote and they form the government. So majority peoples are out of that political party. They are, most of them will not be benefited by the decisions, by the outcomes, come out from the government. As a result, we are in a procedural democracy, but we are not in a substantive democracy. For substantive democracy, the outcomes, the decisions, the law, the schemes, the policy, the projects taken by the government should be benefited to all, should be benefited to all, irrespective of the ruling party or non-ruling party, or all the peoples of the nations. This also means that democracy is and should be the principle of organizations, not only of government, but also the organizing principles of collective life in society. What does it mean? The substantive democracy means democracy does not mean only to create the government, only to form the government, but democracy must fulfill the aim of the peoples, of the society, for their common development, for the fulfillment of the common interest. Common interest. So fulfillment of the common interest or the collective life of the peoples should be the prime goal, primary goal of the democracy. And it is only seen in case of substantive democracy, not in procedural democracy. So we have realized these two ones. One is procedural democracy, another is substantive democracy. Procedural democracy means regular elections, structure of a democratic legislature, structure of a democratic executive, structure of a democratic judiciary system, police system, offices, institutions, associations, and etc. These are the procedural. When all these are formed on the basis of democratic principles, then we can say that it is a democratic state, and that is only the procedural democracy. Okay. Though all the institutions, all the institutions democratically organized, yet they may or may not fulfill the basic aim and goals of the democracy. If the basic aims and objectives can be fulfilled by the democratic government, then it turns into a substantive democracy, not the procedural democracy. It will turn into substantive democracy. So we can say these both type of democracy are essential, procedural and substance. Substance means the aim, objectives and goal which is actually wanted, which is actually expected by the peoples. On the other hand, procedure is essential to fulfill the expectation of the peoples in a structured way, in a disciplined way, and in a systematic way. So for systematic implementation of the democratic process, procedural democracy is essential. To attain the actual aim, objectives and goal of the democracy, substantive democracy is essential. Then come to the other types of democracy. To achieve the goal or to achieve the goal of the democracy substantially or procedurally, then we may divide the democracy in some part. It may be representative democracy, participatory democracy, deliberative democracy, social democracy, and cosmopolitan democracy. So democracy can be divided in this way: representative democracy, participatory democracy, deliberative democracy, social democracy, and cosmopolitan democracy. Five types of democracy we are going to discuss according to your syllabus, according to your book. What is the representative government or representative democracy? Representative democracy means when the decision-making process of the government is formed on the basis of the representations from the peoples. That is called representative democracy. When people select their representative to take the decisions of the nations, to take the decisions of the state, to make the law of the state, to make the principles of the state, to project the plan, to implement the schemes, take in some policy. So if it is on the basis of representative, it means not by the all peoples, but through the representative of the all people, representative of the all peoples, then it is known as representative democracy. Second one is participatory democracy. What is participatory democracy? Participations of every individual citizen in political decision-making process. representative democracies, all people cannot participate. Only the representative can participate. But in participatory democracy, the individual, the citizens, they get their rights to take part in the decision-making process. Like we can give the examples of Gram Sabha in a Panchayati Raj system. In a Gram Sabha, every citizen of the place can take part in the decision-making process. Though we have not seen in actually in our place till today, but the basic norms, basic ideal of the Gram Sabha is that give the right to every citizen so they can take part in the decision-making process or the political process of the nation. This is the participatory democracy when all peoples can participate in the decision-making process. Deliberative democracy. What is the deliberative democracy? Deliberative democracy values open and public deliberations on issue of common concern. Persuasion, conversions is the best basis of the political power. When we decide something on the basis of discussion, on the basis of the debate, on the basis of analysis, on the basis of common effort, and if we able to take a decisions which is well known to everyone for the greater interest of the society, then it will become the deliberative democracy. Especially deliberative democracy means when the decision-making process follows the principles that the final decisions will be taken on the basis of discussion, on the basis of debate, on the basis of analysis, on the basis of evaluations, on the basis of conversations, on the basis of persuasions, that it will become the deliberative democracy. For examples, when we see in a parliament, when a law is made on the basis of the discussion, on the basis of the debate, on the basis of analysis made by the members of the parliament, and decision has been taken after that, this is the deliberative democracy. Or if a issue is sent to the common people and peoples get the rights to discuss all the matters of the state, of the problem or any issue, and if the discussion analysis made by the peoples, when we make another solutions on the basis of this discussion, then it will turn into deliberative democracy. So in very simple way, we can say deliberative democracy means take the decisions on the basis of evaluation, analysis, discussions of any topic. On any topic, when we take a decisions on the basis of debate, on the basis of discussion, on the basis of evaluation. Then the social democracy. What is social democracy? Social democracy is a form of democracy that is based on strong commitment to equality. Equality, social democracy. We can keep in mind very easily if we know the concept of socialism. When a democratic state pays more important on the establishment of equality, give the equal rights to the peoples, when all peoples are treated equally, then that will become the social democracy, where everyone will get their rights equally. Then come to the concept of the cosmopolitan democracy. Cosmopolitan democracy. What is this cosmopolitan democracy? Cosmopolitan means it is a mixture of many things, but we can realize it as one. It is a combination of many things, but we can categorize in one. What is this? It is believed that democracy must also respond to the challenges beyond the border of the nation state. Globalization from the below, global governance are the core issue. So, what is the cosmopolitan democracy? When we think not about the democracy of a state, not of the democracy of a nation, of a country, but democracy in the world, world democracy concept. Every man must get the rights, equality, liberty, fraternity, and justice all over the world. Then we can say such type of ideology is a cosmopolitan ideology of democracy. Here we can discuss the word like globalization. So what is globalization? Every man has the rights to develop his personality, and his personality may help him to expose himself not in a state but in the world as a whole. Now, we must think about the globe, not about a state. So global governance, how the globe will be controlled and conducted, it should be democratic. Globalization, how the economy will be determined on the basis of the giving liberty to every people. This is the cosmopolitan democracy. It means the democracy cannot be confined inside a state or inside a nation only. The democracy is a world concept and it should be implemented in all over the world. That is the cosmopolitan democracy. Then come to the summary, what we have taught till here. In this unit, we examine the historical evolution of democracy from the ancient Athens to the modern world. We then proceeded to study democracy in relations to the family of the concept in which it embedded autonomy, rights, liberty, and equality. We examined to both types of justification of democracy, both types of justification of democracy, intrinsic and instrumental, drawing a distinction between procedural and substantive democracy. We also examined the various types of democracy like representative democracy, social democracy, participatory democracy, deliberative democracy, and cosmopolitan democracy, various types of democracy. Democracy, social democracy, and democracy, social democracy, and of a vital concern for the future of the cosmopolitan democracy. Also, we have discussed the four basic issues of the democracy: desire, equality, liberty, fraternity, and justice. So, for this, the democracy has crossed a long history. Democracy has crossed a long time and is still trying to establish the real equality, real liberty, real fraternity, and real justice. And when any state, any country will able to establish, able to prove that they are success in establishment of equality, in providing of liberty, in maintaining of fraternity, and in establishment of justice, then we can say that state will be the real democratic state of the world. So till here, all the language, most of the language, most of the words I have taken from the study materials of IGNU. And I am recording this video with the help of the Cisco WebEx. And you can find this video in YouTube channel in my name. And you know, my name is Dhiren Tamuli. If you go to the YouTube and click my name, then you will get not only this class, many classes what I have already taken till today. So I request you kindly subscribe my channel and you can give your feedback whether you are liking it or not. Okay.
সঁচাকে কৈছো বহুতখিনি মানে আপুনি মানে ক্লিয়াৰকে কনচেপ্টটো দিছে কিতাপত পোৱাৰ উপৰিও এনেকে পাই ভাল লাগিছে ছাৰ নেচাৰৰ আৰু ছিগনিফিকেন্সৰ অফ পলিটিকেল থিয়ৰীৰ বিষয়ে অলপমান কৈ দিব পাৰিব নেকি
হয় হয় মই শুনিছোঁ ঠিক আছে মই নেচাৰ অফ দ্য পলিটিকেল থিয়ৰী এণ্ড ছিগনিফিকেন্স অফ দ্য পলিটিকেল থিয়ৰী এইটো আমি আলোচনা কৰিম বুলি ভাবিছোঁ গতিকে সেই বিষয়ে এই মই ডিছকাছ কৰিম ভাল কুৱেশ্যন আৰু ভাল লাগিছে তোমালোকে ক্লাছটো ভাল পাইছা বুলি কৈছা গতিকে তোমালোকে ভাল পোৱাতেই আচলতে আমাৰ ভাল পোৱাত ক্লাছটোৰ গুৰুত্ব এটা থাকিব মই আৰম্ভ কৰিম যে অ'কে নাও আই এম গোয়িং টু ক্লেৰিফাই দ্য কুৱেশ্যনছ আস্কড বাই কল্পনা কোঁৱৰ ৰিগাৰ্ডিং দ্য নেচাৰ অফ দ্য political theory. If you hearing my voice, Kalpana, then don't unmute your phone, microphone. Just listen my my analysis very carefully. Okay? Then, in the political theory, we have discussed about the introduction part, meaning, nature, and scope. What is political theory? Definitions of the political theory. Then, political theory and its implementations, characteristics of the political theory contents, and the nature of the political theory. Now come to the concept of the nature of the political theory. What is the nature? When we talk about the nature of anything, then we must know the basic concept, basic issues, basic characteristics of the concept. What is political? Political is nothing but, or political science is nothing but, it deals with the state and government. When we think any political phenomena in a proper way, then it may be a subject matter of political theory. So, what was the political theory in the past? What is the political theory of the middle age period? And what is the political theory in the modern period and now in the contemporary period? When we discuss the whole scenario of the political theory or evolution of the political theory, then we can realize the nature of the political theory. Before we analyze the nature of the political theory, we must know the core issue of the political science, core issue of the political science and its main subject matter in ancient period, in medieval period, in modern period, and in the contemporary period. And if we go from, if we study it from the ancient period to till today, then we will able to see that the nature of the political theory is dynamic. The nature of the political theory is dynamic. It is not static. It means its objectives, its ideology, its basic characteristics, its subject matters have been changing, or more and more subject matters are added in the jurisdictions of the political science. As a result, the theories, the jurisdictions of the theory, political theory is also going wider and wider day by day. Political theory is said to be political thought. What is political theory? Political theory is said to be a political thought. And that is why there are some who describes political theory as denoting the works of numerous thinkers. But it is not what political thought is. Generally, we can realize the political theory, political scenario, political phenomena, political ideology on the basis of the writings which are already published by the various political scientists. So many times we think that the political theories are the contribution of the theorist only. But those theories who develop the political theory, this is not developed automatically. Their development, their ideology, their interpretation, their analysis, their explanations were based on the time and situations or the problems which they have seen during their own period faced by the state. There are others who equate political theory with political philosophy. And in the nature of the political theory, according to your book, according to the study materials of the IGNO, it said that we can study the political theory by making comparisons its relationship with other subject, like political theory as a philosophy, political theory as a history, and political theory as a basis of science. So, how political theory is philosophy, how political theory is history, and how political theory is the science? If we can analyze it, that would be the nature of the political theory. What is philosophy? Come to the concept of the philosophy. What is philosophy? Philosophy means the depth understanding of any issue. Philosophy is based on the concept of morality and ethics. Philosophy is based on the principles to find out what is right and what is wrong, what should be and what should not be. So, as a philosophy, what the rules played by political theory? Political theory played what type of state should we want? What type of state should be? How we can create an ideal state? This is the basic aim of the traditional political theories or the all political scientists. So, without a philosophy, without an ideology, without a depth understanding about the society, about the future of the society, about the nature of the society, we can create the political theory. From that perspective, political theory is a philosophy. But keep it in your mind, all philosophical ideology are not political, all political theory are not philosophical. Only those philosophical ideology are political, which are directly or indirectly related to the political phenomena, like state government, election, executive, legislature, judiciary, human behavior, except when we discuss it on the basis of the philosophical point of view, then it will become the philosophy. This is the political philosophy. Then what is the history? Seeley said that without history, political science is rootless. And without political science, history is fruitless. It means history is the background, history is the backbone of the politics. History is the backbone of the political theory. How political theory developed? On the basis of the ruling nature, government nature, formation of the government natures of the past. Political theorists, they are developing their theory on the basis of the history, what it was, how the state was controlled, how state was conducted, what were the characteristics, features of the king, monarch, what is the royal family, how they able to control the nations. On that basis, when we analyze the political science and what type of state it should be, then that is the historical relationship with politics. It means if we don't give importance on the history, then we can't find out the root of the politics. And politics is the fruit. Fruit is the result. It is the outcome. So why it is the outcome? It is because when we repeatedly analyze the history, when we examine the historical facts, historical phenomena, historical ideology, historical principles, then we will get something new. We can expect something new. And these expectations may become the backbone of the politics. It is because we want change. We want positive results from the state. And positive results of the state we can get when we can able to draw a future picture. And future picture must be based on historical experience, historical observation, historical analysis. Then come to the concept of political theory as a science. When we think about the science, what is science? Science means establishment of the real truth, like hydrogen 2, oxygen 1 equal to water. It is the universal truth. But how we can establish the political theory as a science, as a scientific concept, which will be accepted by everyone? Political theories, they are trying to establish political science as a science. It means that they are wanting, they have been trying to create such type of ideologies, such type of principles, such type of objectives, which will be accepted by the all peoples. That these are the core issue of political science. It is trying, but we are not able to accept it yet. The most of the political theory, they are trying to make the political science as a science by interpreting the political issues, by analyzing the interpreted issue on the basis of the fact and data. Fact and data. Like natural science, political science cannot be studied in a laboratory, but on the basis of experiencing the human nature, human behavior towards the political system, we can frame a universal decisions. And if we are able to frame the universal decisions, then political theory will become science. So, to rationalize the ideology, to rationalize the outcomes, to rationalize the decisions of the political thinkers, when they are trying to establish it on the basis of scientific method, then political theory will become science. So in contemporary period and in the modern period, every political scientist trying to establish the universal truth, universal decisions, or common decisions, common truth in the field of political theory, in the field of political science. So political theory as a philosophy, political theory is a history, and political theory as a science. So on the other hand, the nature of the political theory, we also can say that in traditional period it was normative, it was value laden, it was based philosophical, it was historical. Originally, political theories were normative, historical, descriptive, philosophical, ethical, like that. In modern period, political theories are based on method, based on the data, based on fact, based on analysis, based on empirical study, and based on rational analysis. So traditional was idealistic, and modern political theories are realistic in nature. So when we discuss about the nature of the political theory, we must mention about all these things, like how it is philosophical, how it is historical, how it is scientific. What it was in traditional period, what it is in modern period. So if we can discuss all this, then we will get the basic nature of the political theory. Besides that, the modern political theory pays importance on the human behavior, to study about the human behavior. Not only the state, not only the government, but also the human behavior towards the states. To study the human behavior towards the state. So this is the basic theory of the basic nature of the political theory. So we have already covered 45 minutes of the class. So I want to stop in here. Significance of the political theory we will discuss in another day. Okay.